This show is so good that I was getting a little upset watching it as a Poison Ivy fan. I was like, Poison Ivy, you should sue! But then, in the second episode, Dr. Jason Woodrue showed up, and I was like, ooh, maybe Dr. Pamela Isley ain't too far behind. Because while Woodrue has his history with Swamp Thing, he also, in some of the versions of Poison Ivy, I think the most popular one, is responsible for her origin story. Well, I don't want to give too much away. But anyway, Poison Ivy is badly needed here to balance out the ecosystem, because not only is this little Louisiana town charming, by the way, it's not just overrun with vines, vegetation, and mystery. I appreciated, by the way, the Columbo shoutouts. But it's also overrun with hot guys. Andy Bean, Henderson Wade, I looked them all up. Leonardo Nam. I mean, some of them I knew. I was like, I've seen that guy around sometimes. And then some of them are a delightful introduction. And then also, Mr. Ian Ziering. Now, Crystal Reed, Maria Sten, who's Miss Denmark, by the way, with an amazing American accent, and Jennifer freaking Beals, they are certainly doing a great job representing the female side. But they're simply outnumbered, especially because Sten and Beals don't have very much screen time in the first two episodes made available for the press. Now, clearly, the show is taking the soap opera route of giving Reed's Dr. Abby Arcane plenty of dating options, and it's working. Highly entertaining. Abby Arcane is a cool name, right? Sorry, Dr. Abby Arcane. And she seems like a doctor, which is really a plus. That's great. You know, you want your characters, particularly the female ones, not to seem like it's just some kind of play acting. But Abby Arcane is a great name. And as someone who's familiar with the comics, I'm not super familiar with the Swamp Thing, Animal Man, and there's a these things all kind of blended together, literally, with the New 52. I read them for a while. They were quite good, actually, at the beginning, and I think a lot of this is based on those stories. But then they kind of got a little too Westworldly, let's just say, in terms of like being too detailed, too philosophical, a little more work than entertainment to follow. But hopefully this show won't fall into the same trap. But I did like it from the time that I read it, and Abby Arcane had some really cool stuff to her own story. So I know some of the stuff that's coming up. Don't worry, I'm not going to give it away, but I will say she has quite a makeover ahead of her. I'm so excited. You know I do love to talk about hair and makeup, and hers looks excellent here. Now, there's a lot of great DC mythology. Not only is there a potential connection to Dr. Pamela Isley, a.k.a. Poison Ivy, but they have an exciting new version of Madame Xanadu in the mix. I mean, shared universes, man. I keep telling you, this is where it's at. That's the magic. And it's so much fun to be like, oh, I know that character, and oh, yeah, that does kind of tie in here, or I never thought of tying it in that way. I mean, putting Madame Xanadu in the middle of Louisiana, voodoo country, that's really fantastic. So I'm very happy with this show from a comic book perspective, as well as just, you know, as entertainment. Now, by the way, Sten and Nam's characters are both LGBT. And overall, this show has one of the most balanced casts I've ever seen in terms of ethnicity, gender, and sexuality. And it never comes across as tokenism, in large part by the fact that everyone does a great job as an actor. Everyone's really talented. I mean, I think they have a very good. I don't know if it's like an amazing script, but they have a strong script to work with, and they really do a good job delivering their lines, including industry veterans Will Patton and Virginia Madsen as the town's resident evil rich people. Every town has one. Now, DC Universe is currently $75 a year. I signed up for it, and I didn't know I'd be getting all the episodes for free as a member of the press. Darn it! But I do enjoy watching like the Batman animated series on there as part of my subscription. And it's $8 a month. So I think with Swamp Thing, they might have finally reached the tipping point where there's enough quality content on the service to make it worth the investment. And if you don't believe me, it has a 7-day free trial. But take note, Swamp Thing doesn't debut until next Friday, May 31st, and only runs weekly instead of binging, which continues to be a horrible mistake on the part of DC Universe. I loved watching these first two episodes back to back. I think I would have sat down and watched the whole rest of the show if it was available to me. I think many people would. I think it's a lot to ask people to keep coming back week to week when there's so much other stuff going on to a streaming service that, to be honest, isn't a part of people's routines. People log on to Netflix all the time, so they might as well click on something or they might come back to it. But DC Universe isn't like always on the forefront of people's entertainment options, right? If they're even subscribed to it. For instance, Doom Patrol, even though I really enjoyed the episodes that I saw, I just couldn't make myself keep coming back to it, especially because it's way too long at 15 episodes. But what I did see again, as I said, of Doom Patrol was quite good. I thought Titans was surprisingly strong, and Young Justice Outsiders definitely has its moments, if not being a little bit too convoluted. But Swamp Thing is the best show on the DC Universe streaming service yet, and the closest to the kind of shows that you find on Netflix or HBO. I think it's the closest to an actual movie that they have here rather than network TV, which is a problem, I think, for both Doom Patrol and Titans. Those seem a little bit more CW, and Swamp Thing is more Umbrella Academy. I know, how fabulous is that? Perhaps it's because Swamp Thing has movie people making it. James Wan is exec producing. His brand only grows stronger. I've not seen James Wan. I mean, I know some people are disappointed with a couple of his recent Conjuring spinoffs, but I think I guess some of the things were a little underwhelming, but for the most part, I think he's really reliable as a brand. Speaking of the Conjuring universe, writer Gary Doberman, who's directing the next Annabelle film, he's a co-creator on this show, along with Mark Verheiden, who worked on Netflix's Daredevil, one of the stronger comic book streaming shows. I think many of us feel the strongest. Well, Underworld's Len Wiseman directed the first two episodes. Now, he's recently been doing a lot of television, but, you know, he still has that movie experience. The cinematography, special effects, and locations are all excellent. Sten's pier with a big fire at the end of it to hang out around, that was particularly nice. She has a very nice house for a journalist of a weekly publication. But you know what? That's how movies and TV always roll, right? But amazing production values, basically. Again, the special effects for all the vines and everything, really strong. Especially on a show for a streaming service, not a lot of people are watching because they can't be watching it because nobody's really talking about any of these shows. I mean, everybody talks about them when their trailers debut, when the reviews first come out. But again, and also I think that week to week, you know, not everything can be a Game of Thrones. HBO has kind of like a special situation, which is maybe why they don't want to throw it away. We'll see if Watchmen can be week to week appointment viewing. But for the most part, it's good. The binging is what works. Although even shows like Sabrina have sometimes slipped away. It's tough out there. There's a lot of competition. But I think Swamp Thing deserves to be seen. Very good. And it's at its heart, despite all these qualities I just listed, it's really two excellent performances. Crystal Reed made a character on Gotham who could have been quite annoying, a lot of fun. That was my introduction to her as an actress. I know some of you know her from other shows and movies, but she's, I think, a very strong actress, very likable, and she's excellent here. They give her a lot of nuances to play to her character. She has a mystery in her past as well, which I think is very cool. I like that development. And I couldn't be happier than I am with Dr. Abby Arcane. Great female character. And I hope that Swamp Thing himself can somehow suck his vines back into his body, because I don't want to lose Andy Bean after just one episode. I can't believe how charismatic this guy is. His still photos do not do him justice. Wow. If only the rest of the It Chapter 2 casting turns out to be this strong. And he has a small role in It Chapter 2, unfortunately. This guy's amazing. Somebody should pick him up very quickly and for like a movie or a bigger... I'm sorry to say, I mean, this is a very high... Swamp Thing's a great show, but this guy's so talented. He's movie star or at least, you know, top-notch television material. And I hope Swamp Thing is recognized to be the top-notch show that it is, but I don't know if anyone's going to find it in the swamp of DC Universe. I'm sorry. I hope more people subscribe to this. I think that Warner Brothers should try and find a way. They do. They make some of the shows free for people to watch. And they should make the first episode of Swamp Thing free for everybody to watch. I think that it would benefit them. So also, speaking of talented actors, I was glad to see RJ Seiler show up in the first episode, even if for just a few minutes, but at least he did not die first. This show is very scary. I jumped several times while watching the first two episodes, which is a weird experience to do at home on your sofa instead of at the movie theater. So anyway, I think so far Swamp Thing is top notch. And I think, by the way, even though the Swamp Thing team did a heck of a lot of complaining about it, I think the DC Universe team did them a favor by cutting them down to a tight 10 episodes. You know, you don't want to go on for too long. I think 13 is too long. 15 was ridiculous for Doom Patrol. I think 10 might even be too much. I think Stranger Things is really good at around 8. I think that's a really good number. It's like a super two movies together. No, actually even more. It's like 4 movies, right? But still, I think 10, even 10 might be pushing it. Because, you know, I think, yeah, as I said, 8. I'm trying to think with myself, I'm like 6, 8. I think, to me, 8's the magic number. And I'm curious what you think is the magic number for these streaming shows. Oh, actually, we know it ain't 6, because that's what happened to Game of Thrones. Imagine the difference, too. But Game of Thrones is a different type of show, though. I think that could have gone for the full, we would have taken as many episodes of that as we could have gotten for the final season. So I don't know if that's a fair comparison to make. So anyway, share your thoughts down below, including if you have DC Universe streaming service, or if maybe you're finally thinking of getting it. If not, why not? I want to hear about it down below. And of course, as always, you can check out some more videos right now.